left of last time before the test. Really, what we have completed in this first part, these five lectures, is the first part of the course where we talk about orbital mechanics. And as you have seen, it's a pretty difficult part of this whole business, you know, and it takes astrophysicists or those people that do that for a living to be really good at it. My hope was that by doing some of these things, you get at least some idea about how these things fly around and what are some of the things to consider. The next three lectures are going to be kind of overview, really talking about satellite as a system, what kind of things there need to be on a satellite for this thing to work. I'm not an expert in those. I'm an RF engineer, so I mostly take, you know, study and understand the RF piece of it, how, you know, how to dimension the link and modulation, demodulation, access, and those kind of things. But it's important to know what's on the satellite and what makes the whole thing work. So there are three lectures that we're going to have here. One is the introductory lectures where I'm going to introduce the systems and talk about what I know about them and what is their importance. Then there's going to be a movie that I'm going to play for you guys next class that is actually entirely about how to make a satellite. And it goes through all of these steps and kind of you will hear it from the people that are making these things, what are the things that matter. And then a third part is really what is closer to what we do here, where I'm going to talk specifically about satellite antennas. Because I don't know if you noticed that in wireless systems, everything ultimately boils down to the antenna. Right? Everything else is the same, you know, signal processing and FPGA, DSP, but really what it makes or breaks is whether you can design an antenna and can you manufacture it at a cost point that will make the system commercially viable. So those are the three. There will be no test associated with it. You know, don't get that discourage you from reading about it. You know, it's nevertheless important topic. Okay, so there are a lot of, you know, when you say satellite, you know, and we, in particular, as I pointed out at the very beginning, we're talking about communication satellites. To make the communication satellite work, you have a whole bunch of other systems that are not doing communications, but that are in charge of making making the satellite function. Here are some of them listed. These are major satellite systems. There's something called altitude and orbit control system. This is all the functional blocks that are on the satellite and on the ground that make sure that the satellite is at the proper place and proper time. You've seen that that the motion of the satellite is quite complicated, even in the simplistic scenario where we just assume ideal Earth and ideal satellite and nothing else. But in the real world, there's a whole bunch of stuff that perturbs the orbit of the satellite, and there are systems that are designed to correct for these perturbations and bring the satellite back to the proper position in the orbit. You will see it later on the slide, but when you get a location on the orbit, you're not the only one, right? There's, especially in geostationary orbit, there are several hundreds of satellites in that particular orbit. So you have to make sure that you occupy the right your spot. And that spot is relatively small. It's 0.5 by 0.5 degrees in space, right? So you have to actually do quite a bit of work to make sure that you stay there. Now, along with these systems, there's something called telemetry tracking and command monitoring, TTCNM. And just like any modern system, there's extensive control that exists around the components of that system. If you think about your car, it's nothing but, you know, the very important part of your car is the electronics that measures all the stuff that happens and then reports that either on your dashboard or to some computer and so on. The same thing here. There's several hundreds, various sensors and various probes on board of the satellite that measure and various things and then assess the health of the satellite as a complex object. Now, what happens is all of these measurements are usually relayed down to the ground, where at the command center you get all the alarms and all the status reports. And based on what happens in space, you can actually do some actions to extend the life of the satellite. If for example, something happens to the cooling or heating system, you want to know right away and then try to remedy the problems. Now, once you send the satellite in the orbit, you have to, you know, for all of this equipment to work, you have to provide power. The obvious source of power for satellite is solar. And solar power, and there is a, you know, the whole system there that helps satellite generate the power. You will see there are other ways of generating the power, but for satellites that orbit the Earth, the sun is a pretty good source of the energy. You don't have to go through atmosphere, so you have pretty good exposure to the sun. And you will see there are essentially two ways how we can harvest that energy. There are, for other space vehicles, especially for some that when you travel deeper into space, where you move away from the sun, you provide other sources of power, nuclear power being the obvious choice. But for the most satellites that are orbiting our globe, we use the solar energy. Then there are communication subsystems with all of its receivers, transmitters, you know, and its signal processing capabilities and satellite antenna. They're part of the same thing, right? Antenna is a part of the communication system, but it's listed here as a separate because there are the two reasons. First, the antenna is usually a pretty big structure that's mounted on the satellite externally. And there may be one or more antennas, and even if you have one antenna, it might be single beam or multi-beam. So it's quite complex structure satellite antennas are pretty complex, and their design is quite complicated. We'll talk about it a little bit later, and then we'll talk about it when you see the movie. You will see some of the work that goes into building those antennas. It's one of the major design challenges for the satellite. So that's why they're given as a separate system. Also, a lot of satellite antennas come with pointing capabilities, ability to track stuff, you know, all the mechanical and electrical systems that are going along with it. Now, on the top of that, there is something called superstructure, which is essentially the shell where everything is mounted on. And a satellite superstructure has two principal requirements. First requirement, it needs to be very sturdy, right? Because it needs to be launched and it goes through several G's of forces, and it needs to be very light, right? Because you've seen that everything that goes into space has a cost associated. So you have opposing constraints right there, right? Because usually stuff that is light is not sturdy and the other way around. So there's quite a bit of challenges associated there. And then thermal subsystems, you know, when you're out in outer space, you are experiencing pretty extreme temperature variations, right? During the night, you're close to absolute zero, you know, minus 270 kelvins, and or zero kelvins, minus 270 Celsius. And during the day, you can be, you know, very hot. So you have to have a system that has substantial temperature regulations that is able to, you know, preserve the heat at night and cool down the electronic components primarily during the day. Satellite has an expectancy 10 to 15 years. It is important to understand that it's not the electronics usually that fails. This 10 to 15 years is essentially limited by the amount of fuel that you can take with you. Because if you look at the critical part that mostly limits the life of the satellite is its ability to stay in the orbit. And the way how you stay in the orbit, you burn the fuel. And there is no way that you can right now, that we have no easy way of refueling the satellites, so you have only what you take with you, right? And you take that at a really high cost, right? Like, think about $3 a gallon as being expensive. You know, a pound of things that you launch in space is around $30,000, right? So it's much more expensive in space. All right, there's a kind of map of the satellite and kind of pointing out certain things. When we watch the movie, you will see this much more here. All right, so altitude and orbit control. There are two tasks that this subsystem needs to accomplish. First task is to, as I said, to maintain the satellite in a proper position in the orbit, proper point in space as it flies around the globe. And the second one is to make sure that the satellite is pointing, you know, oriented properly, right? You can be flying, you know, in the right position, but tumbling, right? So you want to avoid it. And the first one is called, maintaining the position. The second one is called stabilization. You have to stabilize the position of the satellite. And there are, as it says here, four ways of stabilization: spinning, momentum wheels, reaction wheels, and control momentum gyro. Essentially, there are two principal ways. One is to rotate the satellite itself, and when you rotate, you give the satellite the momentum, and since you're in a frictionless space, the momentum needs to be preserved. So if you don't have any external forces, the satellite keeps on, you know, staying maintaining the same momentum. And if something perturbs the momentum, then you fire up rockets or thrusters to bring it back to where it needs to be. So it's a typical example of a control system. It's called a regulation problem, where you try to maintain control variable close to zero. Now, these spinning satellites, they look like this. This is an example of a spinning satellite, and it's a specific, shape, where you're like a drum, is because you want it to be circularly symmetric to be able to spin properly. Now, the second approach are all of these three, is where you actually have a satellite that has some sort of masses inside that spin somehow or move somehow to stabilize the satellite. It's a relatively complicated, you know, dynamics problem. I don't know much about it. I just know that these are the ways. And the guys in mechanical engineers write a lot of equations to make sure that all of this stuff works. The example of a spin-stabilized satellite is this one. This is Boeing 376, one of the very common satellites. It's this one. It says here operates in C and Ku bands, and usually 20-foot transponders. We'll talk a little more about these things, you know, when we get to the communication part of the set. But in a nutshell, two tasks that this subsystem has. One is to maintain the satellite in a proper orbit, and the other one is to maintain the proper orientation of the satellite relative to its communication equipment on the ground. TTC and M systems. The way how satellites are operated, you have control centers, and there are several of these control centers throughout the country, depending on who's operating them. A lot of them are around the Washington D.C. area. There's stuff in White Plains. There's all over the place, right? But those are, and what happens is, in the control centers, you get all the telemetry information from the satellite. Telemetry information is typically sent over different frequency than the one used for the satellite operation, right? Telemetry information is low data rate, therefore it's a relatively small bandwidth. And what typically happens, let's say if you have Ku band satellite, all the data communications goes over Ku, and then telemetry and control information goes over even L band or S band, much, much lower in frequency. This allows you to have a cheaper antennas and allows you to have links that are more reliable in the face of the weather conditions. Like when you talk about, you know, higher frequency operation, as you will see, you have to deal with some sort of outage that's due to the elements of the atmosphere. When you go in the lower frequencies, you are not exposed to those as much. So you're able to maintain the connection to the satellite at low data rate that is required for command and monitoring, and your ability to assess the health of the satellite is not necessarily impaired by the atmosphere itself. So even if you have an outage on the communication, you still have a contact to the satellite and ability to operate. Now, what are the things that we receive? Some of the typical things are position sensor. That means the sensors that tells you orientation of the satellite and its position of the orbit. Then you have environmental sensor. Environmental sensors are all the sensors that monitor the health of individual systems. It will tell you the temperature, it will tell you, you know, the pressures, whatever is required to operate the satellite. And then there are alarms. This is when something goes wrong, then alarm is triggered and you get information down on the ground. Okay. These systems are very important for several reasons. Even if the satellite becomes, let's say, dysfunctional on the communication end, you don't want to lose control of it. One of the things that you don't want to happen is to have a satellite that is out of control in the orbit, right? And that's why there is extensive redundancy built in the system, much more so than in the case of communication, because you want to be able to command the satellite even if it's not functional. Let's say place it in a outside orbit or have some control over its descent to the ground, right, so that it doesn't fall in a populated area. Power systems. As I said, these are the ones you're in the orbit. You have to have a ability to generate power. There are three principal sources. There's a solar and nuclear, really, for generating, and then there's a chemical that you use to store power. Right? The way how we store the power, we usually fill in some, we charge some battery. That means that you store power in a chemical energy. As I said in the introduction, solar power is the mostly used in all our commercial satellites because we're still close to the sun to be able to regenerate enough power. If we were on some planet that is further away, then the density of the energy that is coming from the sun would be enough, right? And that means that the space vehicles that are flying towards the outer edge of the solar system usually have some sort of nuclear power to nuclear generator to generate some sort of power. Source power is generated through what is called solar panels, and there are two types of these solar panels depending on what kind of satellite you have. If you have a spin stabilizing satellite, a satellite that rotates, then its entire drum, the outmost layer, is covered with solar cells. So as it rotates, you know, one side is always exposed to the sun, and then it harvests the energy as it comes from the sun. Those satellites that are not spin stabilized, that are stabilized by the motion of the components inside the satellite, usually have solar panels. And if you look at the images of the satellite, you will easily recognize those. They look like wings. They're very relatively large and cover, I guess, because the amount of the energy that you're able to harvest is proportional to the size of these panels, right? And depending on how much of the energy is required by what the satellite needs to operate, these panels can be quite large. Out of these two kinds, the ones that are having solar panels can generate more energy, right? Because solar panels in general, even though they're large, they're actually made out of materials and made out of they're constructed so that they're very light. It's usually just a relatively thin film that when during the launch compresses in small compartments, and then when you're out in out space, you open. And even though it's very thin, it doesn't really break because there's no wind, right? It can stay there. Now, the amount of energy, you know, that we generate, that we get from the sun is about 1390 watts per meter squared, 1.3 kilowatts. So that kind of gives you the idea about how much you can capture, right? At best, you can capture 1.4 kilowatts per every square meter that you deploy on the solar panel. That's the ideal, but solar panels are very inefficient still at this stage. The best solar panels that we have efficiency about 20%. So out of this energy that's available, only one half is being harvested. So that means to get 1.4 kilowatts, you need 5 square meters of the panel, right? And then, you know, if you look at what typical consumption of the satellite, it can be 5, 6, 10 kilowatts, right, of the energy. So that gives you an idea how large these solar panels need to be. Also, efficiency of the solar panels diminishes over the life of the satellite. Initially, they're 20% inefficient, but over time, the efficiency goes down. So when you do the design, you actually have to provision that the energy generating capability as a last day of operation still support the systems on the satellite. So what you do is you over-provision design for the first day and kind of take into account that over time your efficiency will be reduced. As it says here, majority of the power is consumed by communication equipment. In particular, RF amplifiers are the most power hungry because they have to produce a signal of a relatively high power, and they also have to be, as we will discuss later in the course, they have to be very linear, and linearity in power amplifiers comes at a cost. You have to operate what is called class A amplifiers. That means that you are in a linear region of your power amplification, and what that usually means is that you are operating on relatively small efficiency. Okay, so power systems. I'll do a couple of problems on power systems at the end. You know, these two examples will look at some numbers there. Communication systems. This is what the focus of this course is. As far as this course is important, this is this course is concerned. This is the most important part of the communication satellite. But in general, I mean, this is the part of the satellite that pays the bill, right? That kind of justifies its existence. I mean, you can have perfect cooling and heating and positioning and everything, but if it doesn't do anything, then what's the purpose? So everything is paid by this system, and the way how the most common view of satellite is a heater in the sky, right? Its most basic operation is that allows you to traverse very large distances without actually laying ground infrastructure. So you would send a signal, the signal would go back to the satellite, and then go to the satellite, process there, and then send back to the Earth. And in the first class, we talked about point-to-point links, broadcast links, but in all of these applications, you have the same kind of thinking. You're sending the signal gets received, you know, conditioned, amplified, translated to a different frequency, and sent back to the ground, either to a fixed location, which is your hub on the ground, or broadcast or redirected to multiple locations on the ground. There are several bands that are used for operation of the satellites that are listed here. These designators are military designators. They start doubling, but then when you get to the K band, the band ends up being too big, so it's subdivided. Not all of these bands are available for commercial applications. Like for example, X band is the one that is predominantly reserved for governmental systems, so our military and governmental systems work in S band. LS bands are relatively small. You can see that since your carrier frequency is relatively low, there's just a limited amount of spectrum that's available. Also, if you look at L band, that's the band that is extensively used in terrestrial communication. That's our sweet spot for all the cellular and personal communication systems. So there's not much spectrum available there for satellites. So what we actually see happening is the satellite communication is being pushed further and further higher in frequency. There are two reasons for that. First one, there's way more spectrum there. Actually, three reasons. Way more spectrum there available. Second reason is satellites, especially geostationary satellites, are fixed links, right? So you can do a microwave design without essentially what is free space. So you don't have to deal with multipath or attenuation, diffraction, all of this stuff that you have to deal with terrestrial. In other words, what I'm trying to say, it's always line of sight. Right? So in those, that's appropriate for these higher frequencies. And also, as you move higher in frequency, then the design of your antenna becomes somewhat easier in terms of its size, right? Because the gain of the antenna is proportional to the ratio of the physical size of the antenna to the wavelength. So if the wavelength goes down, the antennas of a reasonable size ends up being of a very high gain. And here in satellite, you have no energy to waste, right? The thing that we do in cellular communication where you just broadcast and then hold the cell phone is when I hear that, you cannot do this here. You have to actually to just bridge the link budget necessary here, you have to focus your RF energy and you do that more efficiently with higher gain attempts. So majority, I guess, of commercial systems are either in C-band or Ku-band. Now there's quite a bit of push to start deployment in this Ka-band. In the past few years, we have some major communication satellites being deployed in this band. It's still relatively unused, so you know we are right now actually in the process of populating that band with a whole bunch of okay, so just a comment, I guess, these two bullets. When early communication systems were power limited, what that meant is you know we had a hard time designing power amplifiers that would meet and antennas that would meet requirements to bridge this huge path loss that you're dealing with. Over years, we got way better in manufacturing those, and we are reaching the points where there's a significant congestion, you know, in the satellite systems. And then, what that means is we're now bandwidth limited, right? Even if you are able to deploy the satellite, the question is, how do I find frequencies for the satellite, the operational band, and how do we actually reuse the spectrum that we're given in a more efficient way. And that translates into reducing the satellite spacing, make their boxes tighter so that you can, you know, making our antennas much more pointy and with less deviations in the directions outside of the main location of the satellite. Other than that, you see here when we were so far talking about this part, this is what's on the ground. On the ground we have, and this is a fixed satellite point-to-point link, where I assume that you're just sending information from here and then receiving here, single point to single point. On this end, you're connected to some sort of data center. You know, most of our satellites today are digital satellites, mostly data. Very, very seldom do we have telephony that still goes over satellite. And then you have typical, you know, chain of processing elements where you take information, you encode, modulate, up convert to whatever is the frequency, and then send to the antenna, this is called uplink, you receive it, you translate it here to a downlink frequency, send it down, receive it here, and then the process here is inverse of what you have on the transmit side. Now, there are two types of satellites in practice. One is what is called bent pipe, or just it says here, transparent satellite. This is truly a repeater, right? What is called translational repeater. You have your what is called transponder, which is one of these things for us coming from the cellular world. This is a channel, right, that you have allocated a certain amount of spectrum. This filter here makes sure that it bounds the spectrum that you're assigned. And then you have an amplifier and a frequency translator that will actually take whatever falls within this prescribed portion of the spectrum, amplify it, translate it, and then send it, amplify it again, and then send it on down. So in this case, transponder is completely transparent. It doesn't care what is being rebroadcast. Right? It just takes this portion of the spectrum, amplifies it, translates it, amplifies it, and sends it down to the ground. There are good things and bad things about it. Good thing is this kind of architecture is simple, and it's kind of, in what it does, future-proof, right? As long as you're within limits or dynamics of this transponder, you can use any kind of modulation scheme, any kind of signal that you can send up and then receive or down, right? If you change, for example, let's say you have a satellite that you use for analog communication, and now you want to do it digitally, the repeater is transparent as long as the dynamics of the digital signal is within what was dimensioned for the analog signal. This architecture works. Also, if you, let's say, use one broadband signal and now you want to use two narrow bands, you can, within certain constraint, you can put those two narrow band signal satellite would still work, right? So you have a repeater that doesn't really care what's being repeated. So as such, it kind of is within the limits of its operation, is the future proof. What is bad about this is exactly the same thing that's good about it. And what's bad about it has no visibility of what is being sent. So you have to actually, whatever comes in, comes out. You have no way of switching, redirecting, or doing anything more sophisticated with the signal. Alternative to these bent pipe satellites are these that are called satellites with the baseband processing. This is almost like a switch in the sky. What you do here is you receive your uplinks, and then you actually take the signal all the way to the baseband, demodulate it, decode it, and then once you decode it, if it's within a link budget, you regenerate the whole signal. So the signal that leaves here is completely error-free, right? And that's one thing. And the second thing is, because now you have your bits here, you can actually switch. So you can have the same uplink that says, okay, send this to Europe, and then send this to Asia, and if the satellite is positioned, part of the stream that goes here on the uplink can go through this antenna one direction and to another antenna in a different direction. Now, that's extra capability, but it comes at a cost. The cost here is you have to have all of this processing on board, and if you want to change something in your system, you have to reprogram what's going on here. And that's not impossible. We have technology that is kind of made for these kind of things. It's called software-defined radio, where you actually remotely reprogram this whole architecture to handle different modulation, coding schemes, whatever is within design specifications. Now, majority of the satellites that we have today are of the first type. As a matter of fact, there are very few of these that are operational. But going forward, you're going to start seeing this as a newer technology, especially if there's a particular use model that requires this kind of uh, this kind of architecture. There's something that NASA is pushing. It's called, Network in the Sky. And this is essentially this, but a whole bunch of them, so that you actually have a route, you treat them as routers, and then you have kind of like a network that surrounds the globe that, where these satellites not only talk to the ground, but talk amongst themselves. And then you have other commercial systems or the LEO satellites that do exactly that. So we're moving in that direction, but our majority of our satellites are still this way. Now,
excuse me. On the second part, you said processing the signal and the demodulated signal may result in reduction of the error.
Yes. Okay.
Let me
explain the error. Maybe I said it too fast. Think about this architecture versus this architecture. This is analog all the way through, right? There's nothing digital. You know, the signal is received, even though it's digital digital data, right? The signals are always analog. You know, you cannot send ones and zeros. You send waveforms that carry ones and zeros, right? So it's always analog. So as it goes up, it will pick up some noise, right? That noise will enter the transponder, and what will transponder do? It will amplify the signal, but also amplify the noise. As a matter of fact, it would, because of the noise figure or of the transponder itself, it will degrade the signal to noise ratio as it goes from the input to the output, right? And then that signal with the original signal amplified, the noise amplified will come down, and then you will have the additional noise that's picked up on the down. So this satellite here accumulate the noise as the signal propagates through this whole architecture, right? So when we do the design, you will see that that the overall signal-to-noise ratio is going to be a function of both signal-to-noise ratio at this point and the signal-to-noise ratio at the down, right? Both of them will function. Let's look at this architecture here. Here you have signal-to-noise ratio at this point. As long as that signal-to-noise ratio is above a threshold, right? Then you actually are able to demodulate, decode, and based on your error control coding, correct for all the errors. So if you're above certain thresholds, all the errors that are coming from the down, from the uplink are corrected. And your ones and zeros that are leaving here is treated as complete as a new source of a signal. So when you now look at what happens at the receiver and the ground, the only noise present is the one that's captured on the downlink, because the through the regeneration of the signal here, all the noise that's picked up on the uplink is gone, and that's also, you know, beneficial, because think about who's sitting on the beginning of this link. It's a huge Earth station, right? Earth station that it has a good, you know, that can have pretty large antenna that points really well, and that can be hooked up to a power plant of its own. So it has as much power as it needs. You know, it has a pretty large space to generate, to mount whatever antenna it needs. So you can always, in theory, get it so that signal to noise ratio at this point is sufficient enough so that this regeneration is error free. And in this architecture, really, you know, you just have the downlink that is this weak link that you have to design for signal to noise ratio. One of the characteristics of the transponder is its bandwidth, right? And even though, you know, you can have it with pretty much any bandwidth, there are some channel bandwidths that are kind of standard, right? And most common bandwidth for transponder is 36 megahertz of the useful signal bandwidth, and then you have 2 megahertz on the end for the guard band, for a total of 40 megahertz channel. And what we do is, so the channelization is 40 megahertz, and then you will see in one of the later slides, you actually have 2 kinds of polarizations so that you can do some frequency reuse. SAM satellites adopt higher bandwidth, 2 times 36 gives you 72, and then 1.5 gives you 54. Those exist also, but the most common is the 36 megahertz channel with a 40 megahertz spacing. So, I don't know if you can see this. This is, I think I snagged, took this from your book, or can you see it? Let me explain what is happening here. This is a example of a transponder arrangement. This is a, if I can reconstruct what is going on here. This is a C-band satellite, and you can see here that you have 24 transponders. 24 times 40 should give you. It should give you. Well, it's 25. Let me just. 25 times 40 gives you one gigahertz, right? Or and this is 2 times 500 megahertz. So 500 megahertz are four. So there's a 500 megahertz of spectrum, and then that's doubled because you use horizontal and vertical polarization to give you a total of 1 gigahertz of useful spectrum. You have 24 transponders because you have some guard bands, so you're not able to utilize all 500 megahertz. You have 20 on your sheds that are guard. And then here you have them arranged in the banks, and now the question is which ones are. Which ones are horizontal, which ones are vertical? Does it say here?
Yeah, there's H's and B's. The bottom antennas have H's and B's.
There you go. Okay, excellent. Thank you so much. I couldn't see. So if you look at, they're arranged in groups. So 1, 5, 1, all the odd ones, 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, and so on, they're vertically polarized. And all the even ones are horizontally polarized, and you actually have them in two different banks to avoid the mixing of the signals that are too close in the frequency domain, because that will that creates some problems when you combine these kind of signals. So then you have really here channel 1 and channel 5. So the spacing is 4 channels, so that you can separate them in space, in a frequency domain. So what happens here is the signal comes up at a given frequency. Then, depending on which polarization it is either this is a receiver, or this is receiving vertical, this is receiving horizontal, and then depending on what is the particular frequency range, it's filtered and fed to the proper transponder, where it's amplified, translated, output filter is there to filter out of band emission, and then it's sent through a proper antenna towards the ground. All right, so that's kind of how it might be arranged in a typical C-band cell. Okay, so. Several times, throughout this presentation, I have mentioned frequency translation, and it is one of the fundamental tasks that satellite transponder has to do. It's a translational repeater, so it repeats the signal, but moves it in a frequency band from one frequency to the other. In all commercial In all deployments, you send on a higher frequency from ground to the satellite, then you go down conversion to a lower frequency and send from the satellite to the ground. The reason why you transmit on a lower frequency is to get some link budget advantage. The path cost is lower on a lower frequency. Now, what's the principle behind it? I have the C-band frequencies here. And it kind of illustrates, it gives you the block diagram of what the translation repeater looks like. You have one antenna that will receive at a higher frequency that receives your uplink, right? And in this case, the uplink is at 6 gigahertz. So your input signal, x1 of t is a cosine 2 pi f 6 gigahertz t. This is a frequency in the 6 gigahertz range. Now, this signal is modulated, but I'm just giving you here unmodulated k. So there's going to be some a of t, potentially some phi that shows you how this signal is either amplitude or phase modulated or both, right? Or even frequency modulated. But nevertheless, its carrier frequency is at 6 gigahertz, and its modulation is such that it fits within a prescribed bandwidth of the transponder. If the transponder gives you 36 megahertz of the useful signal spectrum, that kind of limits the data rate that you can send, or limits the bandwidth of the signal that you can send through the transponder. Now, what happens is the first stages here are the stages that are just focusing on recovering the signal. And those are your low noise amplifiers, your filters, things that will say, okay, I'm looking at this portion of the 6 gigahertz spectrum. I need to take everything outside and make it go away. And I have to take this signal that is coming within this band, amplify it, filter it again, and then this is done through this low noise amplifier. These amplifiers are designed with a very low noise figure so that they can hear the signal coming from great distances. Now, after that signal, this is the same signal, it's just amplified here, then it goes to something that's called mixing stage. The mixing stage is where you do the translation, and this is nothing but multiplication of your input signal and the signal from the local oscillator that you have. In a C-band satellite spectrum, there's a fixed offset between the uplink channel and the corresponding downlink channel, right? So it's exactly 2.225 gigahertz, right? And that's not like what we have in a cellular world, we call it duplexing space, right? What the separation between your uplink and the downlink. What happens here, you're taking this signal, multiplying that with a pure sinusoidal at a given frequency. As you know, multiplication with the two sinusoidals gives you two new sinusoidals. One is going to be at the sum of the frequency, and the other one is going to be at the difference. So here, I have, this is the difference, this is the sum. Sum is not interesting to us because sum puts us outside of the 4 gigahertz. We want down conversion, so we're looking at the difference. And here, you know, 6 gigahertz minus these 2 gigahertz brings you in the 4 gigahertz range. So that's where you're gonna take this bandpass filter here, get rid of this signal that is at a higher frequency, preserve this one, and then this becomes a signal that you amplify, clean up, and then send on down. This is a single conversion because there's only one mixer, right? And this is appropriate where the difference between one frequency and the other is relatively small, comparatively small, like in this case. Most of our transponder repeaters are single conversion repeaters. On a ground, it may be more than single conversion because you're taking the signal now that may be at the several gigahertz range, and you try to bring it all the way to the baseband. And that may not be easily done in a single hop. But in space, the pairs of frequencies are usually close enough so that you can do a single conversion. Did you have a question or no? I'm stretching up. All right, so single conversion transponder. Let me do a couple of problems associated with the material here. Examples. So, example start, you know? Yes. Okay, consider a case of spin-stabilized satellite, the ones that look like drum and they rotate. The satellite has to generate 2 kilowatts of power, so P required is 2 kilowatts from solar cells. Assume that the worst case flux on the satellite, so the, I guess, what's the, thing, min is equal to 1250 watts per square. I didn't mention it, but you know this is not constant because as the satellite you know revolves and the Earth distance from the sun is not constant, so the flux changes in some range. Assume that the worst case flux is 1250 watt per meter square, and then the area of the solar cell. So the area of the solar cell is 4 centimeters squared. So this is area of a solar cell. Panel consists of many of these solar cells that that are connected together to generate the power. The efficiency of the solar cell is 15%, and this is this is going along with a comment I made earlier. We dimensioned this with the lowest efficiency, right, that you're going to experience over the lifespan of the satellite. If it starts with 20, by the end of the life, it might be 15. So you dimension it to be 15 to begin. Determine the number of cells. Required to generate the desired power. That's the first one. And the second one is determine the number of cells if the satellite is positioned at the angle 10 degrees relative to the sun. So same as one. But theta equal to 10 degrees. This problem is relatively easy. You just have to kind of put all the pieces together. So the generated power let's call it P is going to be equal to flux that's the this guy times the area of the a single cell times the number of cells and times the efficiency of the whole process. So you take the flux times the area to give you the amount of power that is available to a single cell, times the number of cells to get the total power available, and times the efficiency to tell you how much of the total power you're able to capture. So if from here I can calculate N as being P over mu S. And in our case, we need to generate 2 times 10 to the 3 watts. And we have an efficiency of 0.15. And we have flux of 1250 watts per meter squared. And then you have 4 times 10 to the minus 4, right, meter squared for the area of the cell. And when you do the calculations, this ends up being 26,667 cells. This is how many do you need. Now, so that's how many cells you need under one condition. What is the condition? That all of them are looking at the sun, so that the rays of the sun are falling directly onto them, right? Which, as you know, in the case of a spin-stabilizing satellite, this cannot be the case. This is your drum, as you view it from the top. These are the rays that are reaching this particular drum. So you can see if the solar cell is here, then this entire flux is coming onto the cell. But then if you look at this one here, or if you look at this one here, this one, even though has the same area, it actually receives no energy from this ray. So what we need to determine something that would be called effective area of the satellite, which is actually taking this into account. So let me define the angle here. I'm going to put the axis and call this angle here theta, call this r. Of course, this is going to be theta as well. And I'm going to say effective element, effective area is going to be L times dx times cosine of this angle theta. Now, what is what? Dx is this, right? L is the length of the satellite, right? Imagine a drum here, so L is the height of the satellite. And then this dx here can be said to be r dk, right? The element of this circle here. So the element area here is going to be L r d theta times, or that's right, cosine theta d theta. Okay, so the total effective area is going to be integral when theta goes from minus pi over 2 to pi over 2, right? Because on this side, nothing is illuminated. So you're going from minus pi over 2 to pi over 2 of LR cosine theta theta. And this is equal LR integral of the cosine sine theta from minus pi over 2 to pi over 2. So this is equal to LR. So this is the area exposed to the satellite, to the sun. And this area needs to, this is an effective area. And this needs to actually amount to this number of cells. So that's the effective area. What is the physical area of the cell? Area physical is 2 pi r times L. Right? So that's the physical area. So if you look at the ratio of physical to the effective is 2 pi r L divided by 2 r L, which is equal to pi. So the total number of cells is going to be whatever I calculated here as essentially effective number of cells times pi, which is 26667 times 3.14, and this gives you 83777 cells. So that's how many of them you need to deploy on the total area of the satellite, right? Out of these 84,000 cells, you know, half of them are going to be exposed to the sun rays. But even though half of them are exposed, that's this 40,000 and change, because, you know, the sun doesn't fall on there at the right angle, you're going to have some loss of ability for energy generation, and that means that out of the effectively 40,000 C, essentially effectively you have 27,000 of them working.
Question, so the 10 degrees doesn't matter at all then?
No, no, this is part B. I'm still in part A.
Oh, okay.
Right? So this is assuming the satellite is, the sun is here, and the satellite is oriented so that its axis of rotation is perpendicular to the radius towards the sun. But that's not the case, because remember the satellite,
cylindrical
satellite, you know, its prime orientation reference is Earth. And Earth is kind of tilted relative to the sun. So you're really not not positioned that way. And the question here is, what if the axis of the satellite rotation is tilted to that radius? Then you have another cosine there, right? Because if it's, let's say, tilted like this, then you have no energy, right? Because you're just standing at the bottom of the drop. So as you keep on, if you're at 90 degrees, you get this result. If you're 10 degrees inclined, you have to divide by cosine of the 10 degrees to get it.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
What's that capital L meaning?
L is, if this is a drum of the satellite, this is L. Right? And this is R. Right? So it's a 2 pi R times L is the total area that is covered and this is the only one black. Kind of black. So part B, or part two, if angle is 10 degree angle, then you would have n total at 10 degree. It's going to be this n total that you calculated here, divided by cosine of 10 over 180 times pi. And this ends up being 83, number 85.077. Now, this gives you two things. Now, if you go back and look at the area of the cell, this will give you the dimensions of the cell, like how large the cell line needs to be to capture this much energy. Right? So, you know, that kind of gives you the budgeting and energy that you need.
We don't need to divide this by two.
Divide by two, why would, which?
Because hundred is close to
the I already did that through this calculation, right? I calculate the, not, half of it is exposed, right? But effectively, only 1 over pi is exposed. You know, you see, if you look at this, right, let's say the satellite looks like this, then the half is exposed, right? Because this is now top view, right? Because you see all of these and you don't see these, right? But in our case, it's not like that, because even though half of it is exposed, exposure is not the same everywhere. These are having rays coming perpendicular. These are harvesting only half of the energy because their effective surface area for the rays is half of this area, right? If this is the same length, right? Only if you look at the tube, right? The energy here is twice than the energy here. And if you look at this guy here, even though the area is the same, there's nothing being harvested there. So this ratio here of a physical relative to the effective area tells you what is the proportion of the energy that you're able to harvest. And then even though this is a half of the surface, because you're viewing everything at the angle, the effective area here is 1 over pi times the physical area. Right? So that's this ratio, physical area over effective is 1/pi, right? The total area of this divided by what you actually see, you know, effectively is pi times small. It's less than 1/3. So even though you need 26, in this scenario, you would need 27,000 cells. You know, when you dimension everything, put everything on a drum, you end up needing this many cells, right? Pi times more, but they're now all on the surface, right? And only part of them are exposed, and some of them are not exposed at all, and some of them that are exposed are at the angle that allows them to collect only a fraction. So that's what this ratio here is.
So the angle is zero, the 83777 cells will be exposed to.
So here's the sun, right? And here's my cell. So there's the axes that connect, and obviously this is not the scale. Here's the cell, right? So what I calculate here, in the first part of the problem, the angle here is 90 degrees, right? So now you have all of these rays that are coming from the satellite. They're seeing this half of the drum, but not at the right end. So what is the number of cells that you see? It's half of this, right? But because they're all not all at the 90 degrees, effectively this is how many you see. And then this allows you to generate 2 kilowatts of power, right? As you move. Now in the second part, what we have is now saying, okay, well, this satellite is tilted 10 degrees. And now you say, well, not only that I have half of it exposed, but I have to also take into account that now all the cells are tilted by this angle. And that increases the numbers of cells that you need. Right? And then if you're given the size of the cell, then I can, and let's say I specify the radius or the length, then you can go and calculate the dimensions of the cell. How large does it need to be before you put the communications equipment? Let me switch to blue, hopefully we'll still be able to see it in the video. That the battery system on the board of the satellite is capable of meeting full power requirement of 3.6 kilowatts. So P required is 3.6 kilowatts for the worst eclipse period of 72 minutes. So, okay, one thing that I didn't mention, remember when we talked about some of the perturbation things in lecture 5, I told you that if you have a geostationary satellite, you know, it will occasionally go through the shadow of the Earth. When the satellite is in the shadow of the Earth, what happens? Your solar panel has nothing to look at. Right? The sun is eclipsed by the Earth. So in those cases, the satellite needs to rely on a battery power. So in a times when you generate the power, a portion that needs to charge some batteries that will kick in and an eclipse time. The largest these eclipses can last is the 72 minutes. So T max is 70 2 minutes. The cellar uses cells of 1.3 volts, so battery cells. That have 1.3 volts of the and 19 ampere hours each with allowable depth of discharge. Let's see what is it? How do I depth of discharge D is equal to 80% and discharge efficiency, so that's depth of discharge. And discharge efficiency of 95%. I would have to define these quantities in just a second. So that, what is the question for them? Determine number of required cells. Okay, so, and then the total mass of a battery. Total mass. Given specific specifications of 60 watt hours per kilogram. There are a lot of things here that that are a little specific to this problem, but I'll try to explain to you what is happening here. So this is required power that you need for the satellite operation. You have to have enough energy in the batteries to provide you this power for this amount of time, right? Power times time gives you the total energy that you require. Now you're storing the energy in a cell that is capable of providing this voltage, this current, and now when you store the energy in the battery, you cannot use all of it. Right. This is this depth of discharge. It says here that this battery can recover after being discharged 80%. Right. If you discharge it more, then it may not charge again. Right. And then as battery is being discharged, not all the energy that is being taken from battery is delivered as your electric energy. You know, portion of it heats the battery. Right. And so it says this is this efficiency of the discharge. So out of this 80% of the energy that you get out of the battery, 95% is the useful energy that you're able to deliver to your equipment. So let's see, let's go step by step. So the required energy that you need is going to be your power that you have required times the time. And in our case, this becomes 3.6 kilowatts times the time, which is 72 minutes times 60 seconds, and you end up with 15.552 times 10 to the 6 joules, right? The energy is in joules. That's the amount of energy that you need to deliver. Energy in a single cell is going to be the energy stored in cells, not in a single cell. This is total energy in all cells. It's going to be the number of cells times the voltage of the cells times the current of the cell times the depth of the discharge and times the efficiency, right? This tells you what is the total energy that you can store in the cells. Now, you can calculate the number of cells if you say, well, the energy stored in cells needs to be the same as the required energy, right? So if you make these two equal, is gonna be, I guess, you need to make the required has to be the same as the energy stored in cells. Therefore, the number of cells that you need is gonna be required energy divided by your voltage times the current of the discharge times the depth of discharge times your efficiency. So if you substitute all of this into this equation here, you end up with 45 times 58 cells. Right? So this is how many cells you need to take with you. And you cannot really take 45, 58, so let's say you take 49 cells and launch it. So if you now look at part B, what is
49?
Six. Say again?
46.
So what is the mass that you need? Well, you have the total energy that you require, and then you have this that tells you how much power you can deliver per kilogram of the weight. So if I take the total mass, it's going to be 15 by 5.2 times 10 to the 6 joules divided by 60 times 10 to the 3 watts per kilogram. But I need this, why is this 3600?
What hour?
What hour? But I need this to, oh, okay, to translate this into joules, right?
Yeah.
So 36 seconds and times, you know, your efficiency and times your depth of discharge. So this gives you 94.74 kilograms. So that's the size of your battery pack. And if you look at the cost of this, it's going to be 94 times 74 kilograms. And I have here times $60,000 per kilogram. So it's $5.7 million just to launch this this battery pack into orbit. So it's pretty expensive, right?
That's just the batteries.
Just the batteries. You have to. All right. So that's for today. Next time we're gonna look into more about the, you know, all the components that go into building a satellite.